Hello world, this is CS50. I'm Colton Ogden, and I'm here to introduce you to the games track of CS50, where we'll be taking a look at how to code interactive games as opposed to maybe some of the CLI stuff or the Python stuff that you've coded so far, or even if you've coded any websites thus far in the course. Likely it has not really touched upon game development as it's traditionally known. And we'll specifically be looking at Pong and Mario. And we did actually cover Mario in CS50 in PSET 1, where you were asked to implement a pyramid of hash marks. Interestingly enough, we'll tie back to that. When we get to the Mario section of the games track, we'll end up actually coding a pyramid using tiles the way that it was actually coded, more or less, in Mario itself. And as you can see here on the title slide, Pong on the left, Mario on the right. Pong and Mario are two very iconic games, Pong earlier than Mario. Pong considered sort of to be the grandfather of video games, Mario kind of like the younger grandfather of video games. They were both released in the 70s and the 80s, even though there were games before them, but choosing them specifically because they're very simple to understand and to develop a basic version of, on top of being very iconic. So the first game we'll end up looking at in the games track is Pong. And Pong, as you can see, is very sort of simple, austere almost, game aesthetic. It's got two paddles on the left and the right, which moved up and down, player one and player two. You have a ball in the center, and the goal is very simple. Just hit the ball back to your opponent. Don't let the ball get past your side of the arena. And as you can see, there's a score on the left and the right in the center of the screen. And we'll take a look at all the pieces there, how to draw the shapes and the text and all that stuff. Even you can see there's text at the very top as well. So we're not just drawing shapes and images, we're actually also drawing text, which you've done at the CLI, but we'll see it's a little bit different in the context of game development. Some of the topics we'll be looking at in the context of Pong are, well, first of all, we need a programming language to do all this work in. So far you've used C, you've used Python probably, maybe even a little bit of the web with HTML, JavaScript, that sort of thing. But we'll look at Lua, because Lua, and specifically in the context of a game framework called Love, is very easy and accessible to get up and running with right out the gate. And it's very clean. We'll see that as we get into the track. We'll take a look, obviously, at how to get things onto the screen, which is the most obvious apparent thing to begin with. Drawing shapes, drawing text. We'll look at what delta time means, what velocity means. These two things are very important when you have games that have things moving around on the screen. We'll look at game state, whether we're serving the ball, whether somebody has scored 10 points and it's game over, whether it's the very start of the game. Those are all game states. We'll take a look at how to transition between them. We'll look at basic object-oriented programming, which you may have seen so far in your studies, probably not so far in the course, but as you'll see in the context of game development and in future courses, object-oriented programming is extremely prevalent and very good to get at least a very basic grasp on, if not a super deep dive. We'll need to know how to actually collide things together. So box collision in this case. Axis aligned bounding boxes, as we'll see, AABB. We'll get into that a little bit later. And lastly, to polish off the title of Pong, which is already simple enough, but just a little flavor, is sound effects. So when the ball hits the paddle, when we score, that sort of thing, it adds just a little bit of spice and polish to the game to make it nice. Once we've finished with Pong, we'll do something a little bit more refreshing, a little bit more visually interesting. We'll look at Mario. And we're not, obviously we're using a different tile set here, but the exact same premise of Mario. If unfamiliar, Mario is a platforming game. Specifically, Super Mario Brothers is the game that we'll be taking inspiration from. You play as a little avatar. Down here we have a little blue alien. You can move around a world with bricks and little columns and blocks, and there's clouds in the sky and all those sorts of things. And we'll look at actually how to generate this level from scratch without having to code it ourselves. As we get into the Mario topics here, one of those topics even is procedural generation there at the very bottom, a topic that I'm very much interested in. But more foundationally, we'll look at sprite sheets and raster graphics. So how to actually take a texture that we've written, let's say in Photoshop or GIMP or A-Sprite. We've saved it as a PNG file and we want to import it into our game, chop it up into the pieces that make sense to us, and then draw them on the screen at relevant times. Tile map is a concept that we'll look at that actually lets us represent our game world as sort of a series of numbers, which then gets drawn onto the screen. Then those numbers sort of map back to those tiles that we spliced out of our sprite sheet. We'll look at gravity because in a platforming game, you have avatars that jump around. We need to know how to actually make them jump up and then fall back down in a way that's natural, makes sense. And then we'll look at animation as well so that our character not is just moving around as a static sprite, but is actually walking as they move around and they have a jump animation, that sort of thing. All this and much more as we take a look both at Pong and at Mario. And I'm very excited to show this all to you, and I'll see you in the next video.